Hi, I'm Jess from Another Dream Gone West, and this is my shirt. This is a whatever fast fashion mall brand shirt that I bought secondhand a couple of years ago, but I love it. It's made from linen, it's got these fun puppy sleeves on it. Unfortunately, the buttons on this are kind of a nightmare, as in they keep falling off. I've probably replaced every button on here, and unfortunately, now two of them are gone for good, and they are right here on the center front placket, of course. Rather than just going to the craft store and buying a pack of buttons, I've decided to try my hand at Dorset buttons, or buttons made entirely from thread. Dorset buttons get their name from the English county in which they were traditionally made by hand. According to my extensive research, they were most popular between the years 1622 and 1850, at which point they became victims of the Industrial Revolution. Didn't everything. Mind you, this was never a lost art. Dorset buttons remained popular amongst home sewers throughout the 19th and 20th centuries, and are still pretty popular amongst modern artisans. Just to note, this is not an art button that I'll be making in this video. It's just going to be a simple, functional crossbar design. And without further delay, let's get started.
There are a few methods for creating a Dorset button. The method I prefer is one that creates a button made from 100% thread, but a ring can be used to create a sort of base for the button. In this video, I'll show a basic thread version first, and I'll also show the foundation of the ring version after. You'll need something to act as a sizing guide, like a knitting needle. To determine the correct size, try pushing the object through the buttonhole. Thread, of course. I prefer good old DMC cotton embroidery floss. Thimble is optional, but handy. A needle, and last but not least, scissors. To begin, wrap the thread around the sizing guide. I find 6 times works well for me. Next, unravel a nice quantity of thread. I go for about 3/4 arm's length and thread it through the needle. It can be tricky getting the thick floss through the eye of a needle, and I prefer to use a small needle for this. One trick I have is to cut the thread at an angle, wet it with your mouth, and kind of twist the end. Now, this is the awkward part of the process, and it will take a couple of tries to get the hang of it. Hold the end of your thread in place so it doesn't unravel as you gently slide the wrapped thread from the sizing guide. Bring the needle from the back of the loop to the front. Make your first buttonhole stitch around the end of the thread loop to stop the whole thing from unraveling. You'll need to mind that thread end tail thingy for the first few stitches, but it will eventually be encased by the buttonhole stitch and you'll be able to move much quicker. A buttonhole stitch is an edge stitch created by pushing the needle from the front to the back of the fabric, or thread loop in this case, and bringing the needle through the resulting loop back to front. It's similar to a blanket stitch, but more compact. Make sure everything is all tight and tidy, and continue doing those buttonhole stitches around your thread loop. I'm holding the stitch in place step by step with my left hand while my right hand does most of the active work. Besides keeping the whole thing taut, this also ensures the buttonhole stitch doesn't twist. If you feel like your thread is becoming kinky halfway through, release the button. Those stitches aren't going anywhere, and let the thread unwind. Just make sure the button is oriented correctly when you begin stitching again. When you reach the end, plunge the needle front to back through the outer hole created by the first buttonhole stitch you made to complete the ring. Now it's time for the design. There are so many designs for these, and they get to be very elaborate. but as promised, I'm keeping it pretty basic with a simple cross design. This design is functional. It will create a crossbar for the shank. Create the first line of the cross by stitching from one side of the button across to the other, and be careful to go directly across the center, otherwise your cross will be lopsided. I like to wrap the lines of the cross with thread rather than using more buttonhole stitches, since the buttonhole stitches can get bulky. This whole process is very similar to needle lace. Trace the needle and thread along the outer circle through your buttonhole stitches until you are perpendicular to the first line. This is where the thimble comes in handy. The other line of the cross is created the same way. I like to count the number of wraps on each side of that first line to ensure they're equal, and wrap once around the center line when you come to it to connect the cross in the center. When you get to the end, make a small knot. I make sure all the knots in this are to the back of the button. And trace the needle and thread along the cross to the center. Knot again, and you can use the extra thread to sew the button to the shirt. Now for the ring method. This requires an extra piece of hardware that may or may not be in every sewer's arsenal. I'm using a medieval style lacing ring, or you can use a jump ring or any ring that happens to be the correct size for your button. This ring is essentially your thread loop. Make your first buttonhole stitch, much less awkward this way, and continue around the ring. Make sure you're keeping those stitches tightly together, otherwise the metal will show through. Unless that's your thing, then whatever you want, I guess. When you get near the end, trim the beginning tail or thread so that it's the length of the distance from the current position of the buttonhole stitch to the beginning. Next buttonhole stitch, try to lasso that tail with the loop. It may take a couple of tries, and that's fine, you can always trim it after. But if you can encase it within the buttonhole stitches, you'll get a nice clean finish to the whole thing. The benefit here is that it's a perfect circle, and the whole thing is easier to stitch. The drawback is that there's some extra friction on the thread due to the hard inner core, and it may wear down faster. Personally, I'm a Dorset button purist, but you do you. Caring for and mending clothes is something that is very near and dear to my heart. We forget with the proliferation of fast fashion that all clothes are still handmade. And even if they are inexpensive, the resources used to create them are precious. Creating a wardrobe of well-loved pieces is one step we can all take towards honoring the time and resources that go into our clothes. Plus, nobody out there has this shirt. It is no longer fast fashion, it is my personal style. Thank you for joining me. If you enjoyed today's video, feel free to subscribe. I'll be releasing a couple of videos a month, usually around the theme of sustainability, historical fashion, or both. Until next time, enjoy your clothes.